It's been a couple of years since last time, and I thought we will start with the recent news from 2020 Bulkers, because it's happened quite a lot. How would you summarize, I don't know, the last 5 to 6 months? Because there have been some sales and refinancing and a lot of things going on.
Yeah, so I think firstly, as you said, since we last met, I think we stuck to our plan and there hasn't been any big surprises. But what we did recently is we actually sold 2 out of our 8 ships. We sold them for a price of around $64 million. These were ships that we ordered back in August 17 for 46.5. And it's of course natural for you to ask, did you sell because you think it's over? Are you negative on the market? That's not the case at all. We actually, in a way, are creating, for me, the capital structure that we always dreamt about. And I think now, if you look at the company, we have returned quite a bit of cash to shareholders, around $40 million. But most excitingly, we've gotten in place a new bank facility, which is non-amortizing for 5 years. So we now have a capital structure where the debt is low enough that we don't have to pay any amortizations. And we've gotten the cost down. So we are now at 195 basis points, which creates just a fantastic cash break even. Probably some old and new listeners here, but for those who follow the Capesize market, we have slightly larger ships and they are with lower fuel consumption than the average ship out there. So today we can generate dividends to our investors as long as the market is above 6,800 for a standard Capesize. And that's actually operating cost for most of the legacy ships. So I think we are extremely happy about that. And I know you're going to ask some questions about the history, so I can tell you sort of where we started and how we got there. But that's what's happened recently. And one milestone, which we're of course proud of, is for the people that believed in us when we started, with the dividends that were declared, we will have returned 120% of the equity that was put into the company. And we're still left with a great fleet, with low leverage, and the prospects of generating solid cash flows forward. And the ship should have, plus minus 20 years left of useful life. So far so good, I would say.
Yeah. But that's interesting. So let's go back to the inception point, because you said this has been part of your strategic plan. If you take us back to the moment when you created 2020 Bulkers, has everything played out the way you hoped for? Is this the best case scenario? Because it's been quite a successful journey. Or is it a mix of everything?
It's obviously become a successful scenario, but we've had some pretty tough surprises that we had to tackle along the way. But I think the reason it became a success and the reason we tackled the problems we got along the way has to do with the plan when we started. And I think the thinking was always, in a cyclical business like this, the entry point is extremely important. And I think that goes both with regards to price, but also in shipping with regards to what is the supply side outlook. If we go back to where we were, it was in August 17. The dry bulk market had been horrible, essentially, since the bust in 2009. We go a little bit further back. The dry bulk market was fantastic from 2003 to 2009. And what happened is what always happens, is too many ships are ordered. So there was 1.2 ships on order for every ship on the water back then, and it took a lot of years for the market to absorb that. And when we got in, a 5-year-old ship, which is a good proxy, had fallen 80% in value, and the order book had fallen to 15%. So we knew it was an asymmetric risk reward. I mean, there was a limit to how much lower prices could go, because the yards were loss-making in building new ships. And the order book was at the levels that you really need to tackle growth and scrapping over time. So we kind of knew that we were getting in at the point where there was a lot more upside than downside. I think the second point, which was important for us, is create a cash break even that allows you to survive the soft spots that inevitably come in the market. So we did that, and that's actually a bit of a predecessor for the sale that we recently did. The banks trusted us, and we had access to bank financing for all the ships. And I guess here comes problem number one. When you order a ship, you typically have milestone payments that you make up until delivery. And we had our biggest milestone payment coming in the spring of 19. And our plan was to bring in then institutional investors and take the company public. The only problem is there was a dam accident in the beginning of the year in Brazil, which completely killed the market, and no one was interested in investing in dry bulk. The original key investors, which was Tor Olav Trøy, myself, and Fredrik Halvorsen, we had to dig a lot deeper than I think we ever thought we would have to, and it was not comfortable for any of us, I think. And then we got the good support, and I have to thank, you know, there's many to thank, everyone who came in then, but particularly Wilhelmsen and Klaveness and some families who believed in us. But still, to have the liquidity we needed to run the company, we had to go to get some lease financing, which was both more debt per ship and more expensive debt. And those are the two ships that we've now sold. And I guess we've not been in an urgency, but I think what really kills cyclical shipping companies over time is if you have a break-even that you can't handle in low markets. Of course, it's not black and white. It's if you can have some leverage, you can have a somewhat higher cash break-even, but that means you have to give something else up, which is you need to take more coverage from time to time. But we've always said that these two ships, which we very appreciated that we got the financing, but they were more expensive than we liked. We ordered for 46.5 million. The bank financing was 30 per ship. This was 42. So effectively, there was very little equity in those ships. And we were paying a margin of 450 basis points, which was not so much a problem when rates were zero. But eventually, they were costing us more than 10%, which I think is not the kind of financing we should have. We did another good thing. We realized, a little bit similar to, there wasn't so much lower asset values could go, they could go a lot higher. When rates were low, we thought we locked in LIBOR at 50 basis points for 4 years, because they couldn't go much lower. And that means the spread between the bank ships and the other ships was massive. It was close to 7% in the end. So I think just looking at that, it made sense in terms of deleveraging the company. And I think where we are now, because I keep getting this a little bit, people say, oh, if you believe in the market, you should have as much leverage as possible. But I think it's not really true, because there's so much leverage in our market. You can have a company with a lot more leverage, but then you need to have more contract coverage. And we have managed to, you talk about challenges. I mean, we got COVID in 2020. We were almost all spot, and all of a sudden rates went to 2,000. Well, then we had to go and lock in part of the fleet for a reasonable amount of time to make sure we didn't lose money. And knock on wood, we've never lost money for a single quarter since we got listed in August 19. But every time you do that, every time you manage risk in that manner, you give away something. You give away optionality. And I think for dry bulk, yes, but also for all commodity shipping, one of the key attractivenesses of being there is to be exposed to the unforeseen events. I don't know if you had any shipping analyst on your panel, but if you had shipping analysts, and I think the honest one would tell you that at probably 10 out of 10, at least 9 out of 10 of the spikes that you've had in in tankers or dry bulk, etc. No one was predicted because it happens because Costco gets sanctioned and all of a sudden they can't ship. It happens because of a war. It happens because of COVID when you get contango. So you never know when these things that can create the super profit happens. And I think we are now in a position where it's going to take a lot before we're forced to take coverage and give away that optionality. I think, in fact, with our break-even, if you look back to 1999, the market has been above that level 95% of the time. So hopefully in the future, we will take on the cover when we think rates are good and we just want to lock them in. And hopefully never or as few times as possible because something bad happened and we need to protect ourselves. So that's a bit of the reasoning behind it.
Yeah, I think that that's a perfect summary. And just one question that comes to mind when you talk about your strategic decisions. There must be someone else having that fleet that wants to expand, increase the fleet because it's fun to buy new ships, believe in the market. But is it fair to say that you stuck with sort of like a more simplistic business model and executed on that 100%? Or is there also a scenario where you want to become a bigger ship owner in the dry bulk space or never at all?
We certainly do not want to become bigger for the sake of being bigger.
Yeah.
And I think we are big enough that we are a meaningful counterpart in the market. You know, all interested parties take us seriously. We also manage the Himalaya ships. So that's a very good collaboration. And that, of course, means we get some economies of scale on an already quite small team. But we, of course, if there is an opportunity to do deals that don't increase the financial risk in the company, and is accretive to the distribution capacity in the company, i.e. dividends, that is certainly something we would look at. And I think it's also a reflection that over the years we've been existing, even if we haven't lost money, even if we've returned 120% of the capital to the shareholders, most of the time we've been trading below net asset value or below, and that's not unique to us. That's been a factor in the whole sector. But it, in a way, it goes without saying. If you're trading at an implied valuation below where you could buy ships, it doesn't make sense for the investors to grow the fleet. So I think it's not the principle that says we can never buy a ship, but it has to be the right thing for the investors.
Yeah, but is it also fair to say that since you did those, you sold two vessels, that was also a one-off event, so you should not think of 2021 Bulkers at selling more ships in the future?
We certainly have no plans to sell further ships now. But of course, it's like any other asset. If prices get to a level where we think the rates required to make that a good investment or a good hold for investors are unrealistic, then of course we could turn sellers. But I can say we are not near that at all now. And we are very positive on the market. I think it's interesting. There hasn't been, in my view, so much excitement from investors for dry bulk over the last few years. And I think if you meet someone who's not very focused on shipping, their number one question is, oh, but you are China exposed. That can't be good. And in a way, I think it's correct that we are exposed to China. But the interesting part is China has not been our problem. Last year, Chinese iron ore imports were up 6%. They're up 5% year to date. Their imports of most commodities were up. And that is with the problems that they're having today. And so far this year, I think the trade growth for dry bulk has been very good. It's up around 10% in ton-mile terms. I don't think there are many other segments that can actually match that. But the thing that really makes us excited and kind of, if you ask me to say one reason why we could have some decent years ahead of us, it's because of the order book. And I know some people are probably tired of me talking about it, but I think if there's one thing that you should look at investing in shipping, is how much forward supply is coming, because the demand has very, very rarely been the problem. It's grown most years for the last 30 years, and I think that's much more correlated to population growth than anything. But the order book now is at a 30-year low for our segment. And where we are lucky is that, of course, the LNG market has been good. The car carrier market took off, containers took off after COVID. So there's a lot more orders in sectors that the yards prefer to build. We are sort of lowest on the pecking order in terms of where the yard gets its margins. So they don't really want to quote for new dry bulk ships as long as they can get orders for other things. I mean, today it would probably, if you talk about a similar ship to ours without LNG, it would probably cost 70 something million to build in China. And you get that ship in 2027, 2028, more likely. If you are the shipyard, you can build a Suezmax in the same dock. That actually has less steel. And you can charge 85 million for that. So why would you want to build a dry bulk ship? So that's kind of where we are in context of the other shipping segments. And of course, I think also that there will be inflationary pressure on yards overall. I think we have passed the bottom of a multi-decade deflationary cycle for shipbuilding. You know, in the old days, we were building ships in Norway and then in Europe. And then, of course, Japan took over as a key shipbuilding nation. And then came Korea, and then came China in the 2000s, where, you know, orders were being taken from shipyards that didn't even exist, and they had cheap labor. That's really what drove it. What you have today is you don't have cheap labor in China any longer. There's inflation. And I think the government has rationalized how credit is being allocated. Without credit, you cannot take ship orders, because guys like us want a refund guarantee if you order a ship. Mm. So shipbuilding capacity is probably down 30-40% from where it was at the peak. And of course, at higher prices, there will be some coming back, but I don't think you're going to have anywhere near the supply response. And I don't see the next nation to come in as the new China with cheap labor and financing.
Just talking about, you said, you know, dry bulk looks exciting from your perspective. Do you think it's as easy that tanker seems even more exciting? So that's where people, you know, go to. Or not at all?
No, I'm not sure. I think, I mean, I'm very excited in a way for the order book reason about the large tankers. You have, there's been, I guess we were down to 1-1.5% order book. Now it's 5, but it's still very low. And I think there's going to be, you know, within the years it takes before you can get new capacity on, there's going to be phase out of all the ships, and oil demand keeps on growing. So I think it's as easy as, I mean, most investors chase what they see today. So if they see rates are high one place today, that's where they want to be. I think I at least try sometimes to look 6, 12, 18 months ahead where I think they might be. But I think it's, I'm not complaining in any way, because again, people haven't ordered new ships, and that's fine. It's not like we've had a horrible market. We've made money, but it's been, I guess, a fantastic market in other segments. And maybe it's not so strange that that's what people chase in the short term. One thing that we learned the lesson in 2021, and I think we are on the right side of that right now, is sometimes markets tighten because of, you know, disruptions and temporary things, and you don't know how long they last. In 2022, we had a surprisingly good market in the beginning of the year because there was a lot of congestion after COVID. We were in a way aware of that. But we didn't take cover because we thought it would last. And then almost overnight in May 2022, you started to see the first leg of unwinding, and the market came down. And we went through that last year as well. The kind of second level of abnormal congestion came down during the third quarter. But now we're at, you know, sort of lower end to mid range of where things were before COVID. If there was one concern I would have for tankers, I don't think it's going to go away anytime soon, but there you of course have a lot more of the trade disruptions because of the war, etc. So I think that will probably last, unfortunately, but that's a risk at some point in that segment.
Does that play into the dry bulk space or not as comparable to with tankers?
Yeah, of course we shouldn't be arrogant and say that we are not benefiting at all from it, but I think we're benefiting the least. And it's probably less in the larger ships than in the smaller ships. That being said, I think for a dry bulk market to function properly, you need to have the small and mid sizes working as well. Because otherwise, if you know Cape sizes or Newcastlemax run up too much, then you start getting cargo splits, etc. So the markets are tied together. But I think for Capes at least we were at an extreme and maybe we should have been more cautious and said this, we don't know how long it's going to last, but it probably can't last and taking cover. But that's, I think we have to put it on in the sort of learning account.
Yeah. So you touched a bit upon China because everyone that talks to you ask about China because they pair that to the rates, etc. So if you look at China, there's been so many news stories about the real estate market and all the troubles there. But on the other side, I see some mining companies, especially in Australia, focus on the huge investment in the infrastructure overall, in the clean energy space.
Yeah.
I think one quote is that they poured $1 trillion just in clean energy last year.
Yeah.
So China is more than real estate. And I know
No, you're right. I mean, I guess property is around a third of steel demand in China. But then... You're absolutely right. I mean, clean energy is creating a lot of new demand, but it's not as easy as just saying, oh, what's the GDP level? Yeah. What's the real estate investment? I think there's one thing that's being talked far too little about is what's happening with Chinese domestic iron ore production. Roughly, this is very round numbers. Mm. China imports around 1 billion tons of iron ore per year, and they produce around 1 billion. Now that 1 billion they produced, that was 1.5 billion 10 years ago. So the volume has gone down. What's also happened is the grade has gone down. Used to have an Fe content of around 40%+. That's now being reported around 20%. So that might be one of the reasons that China has continued to have very strong imports in the last, I would say, year and a half. In spite of a relatively sluggish outlook for the construction industry. Of course, they've kept steel production up also becoming, to a larger extent, an exporter. But I think we have to watch those ton miles, and there's probably a reason why Chinese interests are also investing in iron ore mining in West Africa. So one thing is, of course, demand, but watch the ton miles we have. The Simandou project coming on, starting to produce next year, which will be a major ramp up. Vale is now finally, I think maybe people start to believe what they say a bit again, they're hitting their targets. And then of course we have a trade which we haven't talked about, which is bauxite. Bauxite was 5% of the Capesize trade 5 years ago, it's today 10%. And that's new mining capacity coming on in West Africa. And that's a big ton mile absorber because you know, the port and logistics is very slow. So I think you know it's not just the demand; it's the ton miles that needs to be watched. And of course, that's one of the reasons we've had a good market. Q1 surprised everyone to the upside. It was strong Brazilian exports and probably a bit of help from bauxite as well.
Was Brazil, just one comment on that, was that mainly also due to the good weather in Q1?
Yeah, quite a lot was due to the dry weather. Because we have a very pronounced seasonality in our markets, where usually, you know, Q1 is the weakest and it starts improving a little bit around now, actually. Well, it bottoms first in March and then it improves a bit from now. People are saying, well, you're not going to have the strong market in the second half because you've already had good imports in Q1. But I looked at it and If you look at what Brazil has exported so far this year, and you say that for the full year, let's say they end up flat versus last year, you're still going to have 10% higher volumes out of Brazil for the remainder of the year on a daily basis or on a weekly basis. So you should have that season, and you also have the bauxite, which I talked about, which really starts kicking in September.
But is the general principle always reversion to the mean? So even though you can't really map the trends on top of each other, because they balance themselves out?
Or what do you mean reversion for what?
No,
for,
so if the market is super strong, right?
Yeah.
It will have a tendency to come back again.
Yeah, of course. I mean, but it depends if you're talking on the short term level you are. Then it's things like, you know, is it a dry quarter in Brazil? Can we pump up more volumes? You know, is there all of a sudden there's wind and fog and ports closed down in China for a few days and rates go up? So you're always going to have these swings. And it's funny, I read a thing the other day from someone who wants to start an operating business in Capesize, and they had mapped out that Capesize freight is actually more volatile than Bitcoin and all the rest of it. So in the short term, it swings a lot. And it's, I think, as I said, that there's an inflationary pressure. So over time, it gets more expensive to build the ships. But of course, over time, things will gravitate towards new build cost and the rates that's required to build new ships. But you can, of course, have periods in the meantime where rates are substantially below or above. And usually when they are substantially below and everyone's given up is when you want to invest, as long as you can cash flow-wise survive until things turn. And when they are substantially above, that's when you want to think about selling. And by the way, if you look at the sort of period market today, I would say that's still below what you need to get a decent return on the new building. So I don't think we're there yet. But shipping people will probably never change. When things get too good, they will order too many ships.
Yeah, like a law of nature almost.
I
did some research on the different big mining companies. So I looked at Australia and I find it quite interesting because many of the biggest companies see the world a bit differently going forward. Some will believe in the iron ore market will remain strong and it will build out capacity. Some say that India is going to overtake China. So they are seeing the world a bit differently. Do you follow those big usual suspects, mining companies in Australia, and see that they view the world a bit differently? And also in terms of what they should focus on. So I saw BHP believes more in potash, copper and nickel because of renewable.
Yeah.
Is that going to play in? Is that like very long lines that really doesn't come in?
I think it's very long lines. And I think it's nothing to suggest that any of the big miners are giving up on iron ore at least.
No.
In other commodities that are important for our trades, I think this bauxite is important. And, you know, China are producing the batteries for electric cars. They've now started to be a big producer of cars. And for producing cars, you need aluminum. And to produce aluminum, you need bauxite. And China is structurally short bauxite. So I can see that that's an area that they want to focus on. And of course, I mean, copper is in many ways, although it's probably not a very contrarian view, but it's an obvious beneficiary of the electrification of all the world's energy needs. And that's also somewhere where there's been too little investment in new capacity.
And India?
No, India, I think, could definitely have a positive impact on the market, particularly on coal, because that economy is growing rapidly. There is going to be a lot of infrastructure built. And that's, of course, not just steel, but it's also cement. To produce cement, you need coal. And I think coal is another interesting one as well. Of course, the world is decarbonizing, but there's still growth in the nominal coal-generated power, for instance, in China. And we saw a quite big uptick in Chinese coal production last year. I don't see many people talking about it yet, but that has actually turned this year. So for the first months of the year, Chinese coal production is down. And Chinese coal is a very important thing for, it goes more on the standard Capesize than the Newcastlemax, but They import less than 10% of what they consume. So if something happens there as well with domestic production, they have to import more. It could have a rather large impact on demand.
If someone asked you to get on the panel and solve climate change and decarbonize shipping and everything, what would you bet on? Because now you see all the technologies are on the table and it's actually, you know, starting to come out, dual engines, etc., carbon capture. Do you see anything where you would put your chips in, or is it way too early still?
No, I think the best solution we have today, without a doubt, is LNG. It doesn't get you all the way. It versus our ship, it probably reduces CO2 emission by 20% compared to standard Capesize, probably by around 40%. LNG in certain places is now, you know, cheaper than traditional fuel, and the infrastructure is built out. We are managing, as I said, the Himalaya ships. We've done a number of bunkering operations. We see that it works. I would not want to be the guinea pig for ammonia or any of these yet. I think at some point, actually, for us, because we don't have, I mean, we have, they're efficient ships, but they are not alternative fuel ships, as you say. But I think at some point we might start mixing biofuel a few years ahead. But I think this whole conundrum of what do you order is also one of the reasons why the overall shipping order books aren't that large. Because if you're going to invest in an asset that's supposed to live for 20, 25 years, you have to start putting money down now, and you get that asset in 3 to 4 years. You want to be very certain that it's future-proof. Alternative fuels come with a significant cost. And so far, unfortunately, in our business, the charters, they are not willing to pay for the kind of greener footprint. I think the container liners and the car carriers are getting it to some extent because they are maybe closer to the end users.
So they accept that it's getting more expensive, right?
From what I'm obviously not a container operator, yeah, but my understanding is that the likes of Maersk, the likes of the car carriers are actually getting a contribution towards that higher capex. Because it's a very short link to their customer, and they have made pledges to cut emissions.
Definitely. If you, I know you like the whole economy, and you know also like to invest in it. If you take the overall picture of the global economy as a whole, I know it's a very complicated question, but what do you see in the future there? Because it's quite an interesting macro climate right now for several reasons, and we don't have to go through everything that has happened, but what are you most curious about playing out in the financial markets?
I think that there's been an underinvestment in the old economy, and I think if you look at the long cycles, sort of the valuation between tangible assets, value stocks and growth stocks, that is rather large. I think it's an interesting place to be investing. And I think one of the good things, there are actually ways you can, if you want to be investing in decarbonization, in electrification, etc., I think there are ways to combine that. I mean, I think we talked about the mining sector. There's been massive underinvestment there. You have several commodities that are critical to electrification where supply is falling, and I think it's natural to believe in higher demand. So there are combinations there. I'm, of course, as everyone, curious about AI, and I'm trying to implement it a bit in daily life, but...
What have you done there to implement it? Is it ChatGPT that writes everything you say publicly now? Or?
No, I've not used it for speeches or anything like that. But I found a function which in ChatGPT, which is an analyzer. You can upload a spreadsheet and you can ask it to sort of analyze the data, create this graph, that graph, compare this to that. And that saves a bit of time, and it also seems like it's doing it correct. But I'm not smart enough to have invested and made any money on AI. So, yeah. But I think it's, there's no doubt that that's going to be a game changer. The good thing about shipping, at least, it's still a people's business. Yeah. It's relationship driven, and I think that's also, you asked about, you know, what were the critical things in making 2020 a success, if we can call it that. And I think the people have been tremendously important. I mean, we have a small team, but each of them are individually extremely good at what they do. And I think good thing about that is if you have, you know, if you think you have the best people at what they do, you can let them run with it. You don't need to micromanage, and they are usually much better knowing what to do if they're given autonomy. Of course, timing, financing, all of those were important, but there hasn't been a 2020 without, you know, Tor Olav and others to believe in it in the beginning, without Olav Eikrem, Jens Martin Jensen, Vidar Hasund, people who've been there the whole time and really know the company and have the trust with their counterparties. And then the counterparties are important. I think we're lucky to deal with very good charters. And we have a relationship where I truly think we try to approach things from a partnership approach. Of course, in a way, it's not the most complicated business in the world, but on a different level, in shipping, things happen. You know, unforeseen things happen. And then you can choose either to kind of just turn off the phone and look at what does the contract say, or you can make a call and say, how can we solve this together? And these things over time, I think everyone benefits if you approach it that way, and of course it's also the banks. I mean, now we're getting very little debt, but it's tough to be in shipping if you don't. So we're very happy for relationships we had with banks. We've had them all along, and although we thought the lease financing was a bit expensive, very happy that they were there. So I think all these things, all this relationship building, you can't replace with AI, fortunately. So I still think shipping will be a fun place for people to work for many years ahead.
Yeah, but they can do some spreadsheets at least.
Yeah, they can help you out and save some time on the spreadsheets. And
but you talked about the great people you have managed to bring along this journey, and has that also, you know, had an effect on your own personal role, stepping a bit or more up? Are you focusing as a chair, or are you as actively as involved as ever, but it's just, you know, details?
No, I mean, I'm always very much on top of things and thinking about things, but I really don't want to micromanage, because I know that, again, we have smart people, and smart people do the right thing most of the time, and if they're uncertain, they come and ask. And I think, you know, it goes for all levels, on the operations as well. I mean, I know we have a guy called Christian Dahl. He sailed at sea. He knows more about the daily operations than any of the other ones there. So we're not going to micromanage him and tell him what to do.
Yeah. But looking forward for your own, you know, personal view, are you as ambitious to build more new companies all the time? It's like a drug. You always want to see the next case. Or do you get a bit satisfied and want to maybe don't spend 14 hours at the office every day?
No, well, I think there's not a goal to build new things. But I think the problem I have is if I see an opportunity, it's very hard to let it go. So I'm sure there will be, you know, new projects and new things created. But it's also a great pleasure to do it together with other people. I think if you have other like-minded individuals, you don't always need to do things alone as an initiator either. Yeah. And again, also when you hit those problems that you eventually are going to hit, it's sometimes better to be more people with more experience and different views to solve them.
Yeah. I know this is also a very hard question, but we have many young listeners who would love to have a similar career path as you have done, but it's very dangerous to copy others and expect the same results. But looking back, if we're a bit, you know, have some perspectives, have you seen any trademarks of people who managed to build successful things? Are there some commonalities between them that bind them together?
Yeah, I think they work hard. I think that's number one. You don't get anywhere unless you put in the hours. And I think you're more likely to be successful if you are a challenger. So if you're a young guy coming into any organization, don't necessarily accept everything that's being said or how it's being done at face value. So I think it's good, and then try to learn from people who have done things before you. It doesn't necessarily mean that you will copy them, but you will take their learnings and put it into perspective. But I think for young people overall, I mean, the key thing is, I mean, I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do when I started. I liked math and I kind of wanted to get into finance, but you have no idea what it is until you start. So get into a door in any business you want to be in, and get to know the ecosystem, because you don't really know the ecosystem. You can say you want to do shipping, but you don't know what you would enjoy the most, whether it's being an operations guy, whether it's being a broker, whether it's being an IR at a listed company. So I think the key thing is just get in there, try to make yourself useful, talk to people, understand who does what, and I think eventually then you will find out what suits you. And even if that's not what you're employed to do initially, if you raise your hand enough times, there will be a window where you get to try, and if you do a good job, you know, the journey starts.
Yeah. I think that's the perfect ending, Magnus. Once again, thank you so much for taking the time again. It was a pleasure having you on.
Thank you for having us on.